Good day to all. Today we are going to see the costing in a weaving industry, that is for a woven fabric. We are in the first lecture of this kind for the costing of a woven fabric. Let us first look into the process flow chart for the production of a woven fabric. First, we get the yarn in the form of cones from a spinning mill. Next, after sourcing, is the warping process, wherein the cones that are sourced are placed in the creels behind the warping machine, and the warping process is the conversion of the yarn and the cones into a sheet form. So after converting the yarns into sheet form, these number of sheets or number of yarns in the form of sheets are fed into the sizing process, wherein the yarn is strengthened by the application of size paste. So this warping and sizing is only for the warp yarn and not the weft yarn, because in the loom shed the warp yarn is the one which undergoes stress and strain, higher stress and strain due to the shed formation. So to withstand that stresses, the yarn is strengthened by the application of size paste, which is then removed in the fabric form after the formation of fabric in the process called as desizing. Next is the sized yarn is fed to the weaving loom. So before that, the each warp end has to be controlled for the weaving process. So the drawing in and denting process takes place, which is the insertion of the yarn into the heat eye. And the next is the final process, woven fabric formation, which is called as weaving. So the raw materials that are fed and the name of the beams, the formation of the materials is given here. The cones have the yarn, and that is fed to the warping process, and out of the warping process the yarn in the sheet form is called as warpers beam. The yarn wound into the beam is called as warpers beam. The output is warpers beam, and these n number of warpers beam, 8 or 10 or 12 warpers beam with less number of ends, are fed to the sizing process, and the sized yarn is wound into the weaver's beam. So since it is sent to the weaving process, it is called as weaver's beam. The beam fed for weaving is called as weaver's beam, which will have the actual number of ends that are there in the whole fabric width. So this is fed to the weaving machine, and the weaving process output is the cloth which is wound onto the cloth beam. So this names have to be known clearly. The warper's beam number of ends will always be less than the weaver's beam number of ends. Weaver's beam number of ends divided by the number of beams fed into the sizing will give the number of ends in the warper's beam. So this gives an idea with the actual values in an industry. So let us look from the bottom. Bottom is the cloth beam. In the cloth width, the total width, you find the number of ends in the total width of the cloth, that is number of warp ends, 4, 5, 1, 5 ends if it is there. That it is nothing but the ends per inch into cloth width in inches, or ends per centimeter into cloth width in centimeter will give you the total number of warp ends. So this before the weaving process, in the weaver's beam, before the weaving process, the beam fed is called as weaver's beam, which will have the same number of ends as in the cloth beam. Cloth is with the weft, the weaver's beam only the warp is there. So this before sizing, this is the sized beam. The yarn with the size is there in the weaver's beam. So this weaver's beam will be fed in with the warper's beam in the sizing machine. N number of warper's beam will be fed to the sizing. Here 10 warper's beam, each beam will have this many ends, say 472 or 471 number of ends in each warper's beam. Totally they are fed and the output of the sizing is the weaver's beam. So for this warping process, cones are fed. So 500 cones or 600, 700 according to the reel capacity and the requirement in the warper's beam, the number of ends or the number of cones to be fed are calculated. So the 250 and 250 are given because it may be a V-shaped one. This side 250 and this side 250 reel capacity will be there, and accordingly, equally on both sides, the cones will be fed for the warping machine. Next is the elements of cost. After knowing the process, it is necessary to know the various elements of cost. So this elements of cost, we have already seen the elements of cost in a spinning mill. Spinning mill is a total setup with only with each process happening, and it is a total output of the material. Fiber is fed in and you get out the yarn. All are intermediate process, but in the weaving process, it is not a single process. It has, for the formation of a woven fabric, it has especially three processes. One is warping, and next is sizing, and next is the weaving. These three may be in separate places or standalone. Each can be a separate business. Warping can be done as a separate business. Sizing can be done as a separate business, and weaving can be done as a separate business. So each will be a separate process. So the waste, the elements of cost and the control measures in each have slight variations. This slide gives an overall view of the total processes, including warping, sizing, and the weaving process. So, in most of the textile industries, the major component of cost is the raw material. Similarly, for a cotton fabric, 66% is the total raw material, and there are many losses in each processes. There is shrinkage, there is wastage. The length of the warp fed in the warping is not the length of the woven fabric. There is crimp, so, and there is shrinkage due to moisture absorption or the release of tension. And when you keep it without stresses, the fabric will shrink in the fabric form in the cloth. In the womb, in the loom, it is in a tension, it is in tension, and after that shrinkage will happen. And after weaving, during inspection, there may be some wastages happening during grading. And in the sizing, the ends are getting wasted. You have to feed some amount of ends and to wind it to in the weaving machine, and in everywhere there will be yarn wastages. So all these wastages have to be taken into account, and there will be certainly some wastages. Without losses, there will be no production that is happening. And next is the cost of the sizing and the other chemicals that are used in the sizing process. So that accounts to the second component, and the preparation of those chemicals, a large amount of heat is required. So those things account to the power cost in the sizing processes. It accumulates more amount of the other overheads also. So, and the worker wages and salaries are 8%, and the depreciation of all the machines, there is a huge amount of depreciation also happening, like almost 10% of depreciation is usually there every year. Next is administration and selling costs. Those account to 7%, and next is the taxes. For cotton, the GST is 5%, and if you had paid the GST for the raw material, then it can be managed here. And next is the selling commissions. And other finance costs are related to investment which are happening, and the loan that you have bought for the accumulation of the various machinery, land procurement and those things, and also the loan that is procured for the current processing of the purchase of raw materials. So the those things, long-term loans and short-term loans, the interest for those things are all accounting into finance cost. And next, the profit is higher than the spending. It is 10 to 20% based on the order. And next, so totally in the companies, job order processing companies, 70% is the fabric, is the raw material and the other costs, or the direct cost accounts to 70%, whereas in the corporates, it is reduced to 40% due to bulk purchases, and the overheads are higher, or the indirect costs are higher in the corporates where there is large amount of production. So, in the woven fabric calculations, we have three important calculations. One is regarding the warping calculations, and next sizing calculations and weaving calculations. So we'll look into those things separately. In this lecture, we'll see to the calculations for the requirements of the yarn and GSM related calculations like crimp and other things. Accommodation will be seen in this lecture. So the various costs or the factors that affect the cost of a woven fabric are the raw material costs, warping costs, the EPI, PPI decide the cost, the sizing and the chemicals cost, the production cost. But according to the type of loom, whether it is airjet or rapier or projectile or any other loom, whether it is hand loom or power loom, again everywhere there are differences in the productivity, and that has a very huge impact on the cost of the processing or the conversion cost. And next is the wastages and the shrinkages. If it is a job order, if they give the raw material, then these calculations have to be done perfectly so that you do not account to any losses. And this has losses and shrinkages have to be accommodated very carefully so that you purchase the correct quantity of the yarn. Otherwise, you will not be able to produce the required amount of fabric if you do not account for the wastages. So there may be wastages in each processes, and apart from that, there is crimp. So according to the length of the fabric and including the crimp percentage, only then you can find the yarn requirements. We'll see to the calculations related to these wastages, crimp and GSM in the further calculations. The wastages accounts to 2 to 3%. It is actually less. The total of the processes include only 2 to 3% of wastage. Shrinkage accounts to 1 to 1.5%. And again, these things are varied according to the type of the material processed. Whether it is, say, the total value losses will be around 7% if it is a cotton yarn, and only 3% if it is a polyester yarn. And next is the if you process a colored yarn, if the yarn is itself colored, yarn dyed yarn is processed, or a dyed yarn is processed, then more care have to be taken, and there will be more material wastages, and all the processes have to be monitored with more alertness when you use a colored yarn. So the wastages and the expenses are related to the gray yarn purchases, and then the colored yarn if it is a mixed one. And if you buy a gray yarn and you give it for yarn dyeing and purchase, then that wastages has to be accommodated. And then the sizing chemicals and the other manufacturing overheads for yarn dyeing and the other processes have to be included. Let us see what is crimp first and then its calculations. Crimp is the difference between the straightened and the unstraightened length of yarn. The straightened length is removing the yarn from the fabric and straightening it. So that is the uncrimped length, which is longer. In the fabric, actually, it is shorter. So that is the crimped length. It is with the crimp. So the length of the length in the fabric. So it is this length, but it is in a crimped form. This length, and then if you take out the take out from the fabric and remove the crimp, then it is the uncrimped length or the straightened length. This is the crimp, and this difference is expressed as a percentage of crimped length. That is the length in the fabric. That is the smaller length is the divisor. So this is expressed into 100. So it is expressed as a percentage. So let us see the formula for this. Crimp percentage is equal to difference between crimped and uncrimped length divided by crimped length, that is shorter length. The formula is L2 minus L1 divided by L1. L1 is the crimped length, that is the length in the fabric. L2 is the length after releasing the crimp. So if we have to measure this, there is a great difficulty, because how much amount you have to stretch, the tension has to be specified, and it has to be properly unraveled, because we will lose some yarn from that, fibers from that, and the tension has to be correctly set to find the uncrimped length. So there is practical difficulties in this, but there is a measurement procedure and standard procedure available for the measurement of the crimp percentage. Uncrimped length is easy to measure in the fabric. After taking out, the amount of tension to be given varies, and that determines your uncrimped length. So a prefixed tension is mentioned in the standards. So there is a difficulty in the measurement of the uncrimped length. So these crimp percentages vary very widely between the warp and the weft. Usually, they will accommodate more amount of warp so that you will get a higher GSM. Because if you, once you set the warp, there is no problem. But if you have want to insert more amount of picks, then it is based on your productivity. The picks per minute is based on the revolutions, and you cannot go beyond a certain amount for a type of loom. So it is based on the type of loom, whether you use an adjet or a rapier or a projectile. So it differs. So usually the number of warps will be higher, and so the weft crimp may be higher than the warp crimp, but it may be also totally different. The warp crimp may be very higher and the weft crimp may be lower also. So it is based on the type of fabric. Usually for higher productivity, if there will be higher weft crimp and there will be a lower warp crimp. It may be reverse usually, which is the figure shown in this loom. And also according to the type of weave. The type of weave, if it is satin weave, then the crimp of the warp is going to be very less, because only at one place the for a higher, the higher the float length, the lesser will be the crimp in the fabrics. Let us see the various formulae related to crimp. With this, we already saw crimp percentage is equal to length uncrimped. L is the uncrimped length, S is the cloth length, divided by the length of the warp in the cloth, or it may be weft also. So this is crimp, common crimp percentage. Next is determination of warp length. So if the warp length is equal to L, then L is equal to 1 plus crimp percentage divided by 100 into the cloth length, S. Next is the determination of cloth length if we have the warp length L. Cloth length S is equal to warp length L divided by 1 plus crimp percentage divided by 100. So with these we can find the warp length that is to be fed in the machine, earlier mentioned, the sizing, the output of the sizing, or the how much you have to feed in the warping sizing machine, or the output of the warping machine, that is the warpus beam length. Length of warp and warpus beam, sizing beam, all can be found using these formulas. Let us understand crimp with an example. There is a cloth and it is analyzed for the crimp. The length of the cloth is 30 centimeter and the thread is taken, warp thread is taken out of it, and the warp length is found to be 31.2 centimeter. You have to determine the crimp percentage from this. So the formula for crimp percentage, C is equal to L minus S divided by S into 100. S is the cloth length and L is the warp length. So 31.2 minus 30 divided by 30 into 100. You get 1.2 divided by 30 into 100, which is equal to 4. So the crimp percentage is 4%. Let us see the next example using crimp. In this, you have to calculate the length of the warp required to weave 150 meter of cloth if the warp crimp is 13%. The warp length is given, cloth length is given. You have to find the length of warp that is to be required for this, for weaving this cloth of length 150 meters. So the formula to be used is warp length L is equal to 1 plus C by 100 into S. C is crimp percentage, L is cloth length. So 1 plus 13 divided by 100 into 150. So it is equal to 113 divided by 100 into 150. So the warp length required to weave a cloth of 150 meters is 169.5 meters. Let us see the next example using a crimp percentage. In this, you need to calculate the length of the yarn in the cloth, or the cloth length has to be found out. What is the length of cloth that can be woven from 1000 meters of warp if the warp crimp is 9%? So the warp length is given and warp crimp is given. The cloth length has to be found. That is, the length in the weaver's beam is given. The length in the cloth beam has to be found. So the given are warp length L is equal to 1000 meters and warp crimp C is equal to 9%. In the solution, we need to find the cloth length S. The formula used for this is cloth length is equal to L divided by 1 plus C divided by 100. L is warp length, C is crimp percentage. Substituting for that, 1000 meters divided by 1 plus 9 divided by 100. Next is equal to 1000 divided by 109 by 100, which is equal to 917.43. So always the cloth length will be lower than the warp length. Let us see now how to calculate the total number of ends. So find out the total number of ends in the weaver's beam if the cloth EPA is 70 and the cloth width is 40 inches. The ends per inch and cloth width also given in inches. If it is not given in inches, then it has to be converted into inches because it is EPA. If it is ends per centimeter, the cloth width has to be converted into centimeter. So both should be common units. So let us look into the solution. The total number of ends in the weaver's beam is equal to EPA into cloth width in inches. 70 into 40, you get 2800 ends. So these number of ends have to be there in the weaver's beam. For the same problem, if there are 6 warpers beam that is fed to the sizing machine, what would be the number of ends in the warpers beam that is fed to the sizing machine? The output of sizing machine is your weaver's beam. The input beams are the warpers beam. For any number of warpers beam, you will get the one sizing beam or two according to the length. Here it is according to the number of ends. So that, already we have found that the total number of ends in the weaver's beam is 70 into 40, 2800. So now calculation for the number of ends in the warpers beam, that is equal to the total number of ends in the weaver's beam divided by the number of beams fed in the sizing machine, number of workers being fed to the sizing machine, which is equal to 6. So 2800 divided by 6 is equal to 467. So these many number of ends are there in the workers beam.